हेलो हेलो मॉर्निंग डियर पार्टिसिपेंट, टुडे स्पीकर अबाउट मॉर्निंग लाइब्रेरियन की शुरुआत थी। टुडे टॉपिक इज रोल ऑफ लाइब्रेरी इन रैंकिंग एंड एक्रेडिटेशन ऑफ द इंस्टीट्यूशन। तो नाउ मे आई रिक्वेस्ट अबाउट मॉर्निंग स्टार्ट योर टॉपिक।
थैंक यू सोनल। गुड मॉर्निंग, लेट मी थैंक फॉर प्रोवाइडिंग दिस प्लेटफॉर्म। आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक आवर होस्ट डॉक्टर तापस कुमार दास एंड डॉक्टर शनद भट्टाचार्य फॉर कंडक्टिंग दिस सेशन। सो द टॉपिक फॉर टुडे इज रोल ऑफ लाइब्रेरीज इन इंस्टीट्यूशन रैंकिंग एंड एक्रेडिटेशन इन हायर एजुकेशन। So before I start, so this part of my presentation has been divided into four parts. The first part will cover the meaning of higher education, what we mean by higher education. The next part is National Institute of Ranking Framework and the role of libraries. What is the percentage or weightage of marks the libraries are carrying and how they can improve the ranking of the institution. And the next part is what is meant by the world-class university in order to increase the ranking, in order to compete with the world, what it means to be a world-class university, we have to understand that. And then how to achieve this rank, we will discuss in our slides. So when we are talking about the libraries, let me take the help of this slide. At the moment that we persuade a child to cross the magic threshold into a library, we change their lives forever for the better.
ওই মাইক্রোফোনটা অফ করো।
It is an enormous force for good.
ওটা অফ করে দে।
So from the beginning, from the childhood, if we are introducing the libraries to a child, we are making a magical change into his or her life. So the library plays a very important role in everyone's life. And from the part of the library professionals, we need to love our job. Unless and until we love our job, we cannot provide the service to the society. We cannot upgrade our institution, whether in case of ranking or whether in case of making the changes in the lives. So the only way to do great work is to love what you do. If we are in the library profession, we need to love our work to bring the change in the society, to upgrade the library profession. So according to UNESCO statistics, the gross enrollment ratio in higher education in India is 26.9%, while All India Survey of Higher Education 2016 and 17 in its report says that it is 25.2%. The global average is 32.78, and the gross enrollment ratio in tertiary education in North America is 83.8. And in Europe, it is 70.3. These are above the GER of India, with about 50% of population below 25 years of age. The GER is too low for a country like India. So there are many factors why we are low. We will discuss in our next slides. There are about 52,000 higher education institutions in India, of which only 2% are universities. So the bulk of higher education happens at college, with 76% institutions. Most standalone institutions are either educational colleges or management institutes, covering about 22% of the total number of higher education institutions. When we are talking about the library professions, when we are talking about the burdens of the ranking, we should have a look of the burden of education. How much do parents spend on their child's education? We are talking about the India's perspective in the global education environment. So we must also see the poverty of India. So how much the other countries are spending and what we are spending on the education. So the parents are spending on education when we are taking it in terms of lakhs of rupees. The Hong Kong stand one with 83.5% spending on their child education. The number two, the ranking is covered by UAE. They are spending 62.8% on their child's education. The number three position has been backed by Singapore. They are spending 44.8%, whereas number four is occupied by USA, 36.9%. China occupies sixth position, spending 27.1% on their education of the child, whereas UK is spending 15.7%. And we, the Indians, are spending 11.9% on the child education. But it is also a burden for the parents. And if you will be amazed to see how they are managing these funds. See, in the slide, I can show you 40% of the parents reduces their expenses on the leisure activities. 21% work longer hours in their existing job so that they can support the education of their children. 20% reduces their saving, no FDI, nothing for the old age. And 18% take on a second job. Apart from the present job, they take a second job to support their children's education. I'm discussing this because we are talking about the higher education. So many of the students cannot reach the steps of higher education because their parents cannot support this. So All India Survey of Higher Education says that 68% female teachers per 100 male teachers, and the pupil teacher ratio is 22 in colleges. That means 22 teachers per 22 students as having one teacher, whereas in university it is 19. And 28,779 students were awarded PhD during 2016, with over 16,000 male and over 12,000 female doctorates. I'm not talking about any feminist, but this female-male ratio is required in the ranking. That is why I'm discussing about this slide. So this clearly showed the gender disparity in faculty recruitments, or it may be that not many women are coming forward to choose the higher education as their profession. In India, while we are talking about the child marriages and the recent last Amphan storm in West Bengal, we have come to know from the newspaper that most of the female child marriages happen because after the storm, the parent cannot support the daily breads of their female child. So most of the child marriages were evident after the Amphan storm in West Bengal. So this may be the reason where the gender disparity are arising. While the pupil teacher ratio looks good in statistical average, that is, situation is not similar everywhere. And this may not be treated as universal. India also produces substantial number of PhD, and most of these are in social sciences and humanities. In 2016, according to SEI Magu country ranking, India stands fifth in research productivity as per the National Institute of Ranking Framework report 2017. About 90% of the contributions come from top 100 universities. So 88% of universities contribute only about 10% of research. Further, in addition to this, NIRF indicate that India produces about 3.5% of global research, of which 68% comes from top tier universities. In the few next slides, I will discuss about the top tier universities. So, what is higher in higher education? Is it just the level of education, synonymous to tertiary education? Is it synonymous to university education? For centuries, the university has been a place for teaching, research, and extension activities in all domains of knowledge. Most of the times, we use higher education to mean university and conflate an institution to be viewed as a concept. Universities provide higher education, but they may also do many other activities, including providing vocational education. However, a higher education provider may not be a university. It can be a college, a research center, etc. So providing higher levels of teaching is just one aspect of higher education. Higher education educate the intellect to reason well in all matters, to reach out towards truth and grasp it, according to Newman, 1873. So according to Professor Ronald Barnett, 1990, he says, a genuine higher learning is subversive in the sense of subverting the students taken for granted world, including the world of endeavor, scholarship, calculation or creativity, into which he or she has been initiated. A genuine higher education is unsettling. It is not meant to be cozy experience. It is disturbing because ultimately the student come to see that things could always be the other than they are. A higher education experience is not complete unless the student realizes that no matter how much effort is put on or how much library research, there is no final answer. So from these scientists, we can imply that higher education is something that is amorphous and metaphysical. In other words, we can relate this to excellence or quality. It is not just about providing education at a higher level, but about creativity, critical inquiry, truth, discovery, discussion, development, and scholarship. Therefore, higher education is a process that provides the environment for it provides an environment for unsettling, discovering something new. The discourse in higher education these days are focused around ranking as a panacea for all the problems of higher education. We are concerned about the rank of Indian higher education institutions in the Times Higher Education Ranking and QS World Ranking System. There is a need to understand the business of ranking as quality. While there is some truth about what the ranking shows, there are also concerns about the methodology as well as statistical errors in the processes. A quick analysis of the criteria adopted by some of the world ranking system will show that these are not contextual, and therefore Indian universities are bound to face the difficulty of being on the top of the list. In most of these rankings, the quality of research is the main focus. These also look into the income from the industry and the number of international students and faculty. While exchange rate will have impact on the parity of calculations of the earnings, local policies, cost, and quality of living have impact on recruitment of foreign faculty. Just to make a point, the total higher education budget for India in 2018 is about $13 billion. Harvard University Endowment Fund alone is over $34.5 billion. So for quality to be ingrained, it is better to focus on the process than to indicators of the ranking industry. Now, recognizing the challenges, we now have our own national institution ranking framework developed as a response to the criticism of the existing rankings. What it does at the end is to tell us what we mostly know as anecdotal evidence. It's also important to understand that comparing universities just because they are universities make no logical sense. There are different entities with different characteristics. Rural-urban bias in establishment of the universities also affect the availability of good students and teachers. And disparity in the level of financial resources allocated to these institutions are sufficient reason to create different ranks. Suppose the university is in the metropolitan, the teacher will get more HRA, the students, the student background, the guardian supporting those students, the infrastructure, these all matters. So the rural urban bias in establishment play an important role. These do not require much effort to understand. In turn, what it will do is to create categories of institutions leading to the misuse of ranking system and put unnecessary hardship on the part of the students in terms of parity in employment, because the industries, the different recruitment agencies, when they come to recruit the students, they look into the ranking of the institution. So this creates a burden or unnecessary hardship on the part of the students. So the quality in higher education is a continuous quest for excellence that depends on the input of, such as quality student, teachers, good infrastructure, laboratories, and libraries. Above all, a culture of learning. It also needs good process management, such as highly relevant curriculum, academic freedom to think, research, and teach, and cultivate inquisitive mind that question is status quo. So in Vishwabharati, we can say that our founder, Rabindranath Tagore, has cultivated such inquisitive mind that we have a culture of learning. So because of the input and the transformative processes, what we should be able to demonstrate is impact on society. The graduate participation in economic process, institutional reputation. If you're not able to do this, then university education becomes an art of compromise to maintain. The Foundations of Education of Librarianship by J.H. Shera. He says that unique responsibilities of the librarians that no one else does is a mediator between man and the graphic record that his and previous generation have produced. And the goal of the librarian is to maximize the social utility of graphic records for the benefit of humanity. Librarian information professionals undertake bibliographical control, knowledge about where you can find the knowledge, the process of knowledge in various formats to help the easy retrieval. We have online catalogs now, apart from the traditional catalog, card catalog. So for the easy retrieval of information, so optimize the available resources through collaboration and create an enabling environment for learning and research. So you must have marked the differences, what the library was and what the library is growing to be. So the role of library professionals in teaching and learning is not limited to academic libraries. You can take this case of webinar. The library professionals are organizing these webinars, not only from the Vishwabharati Library Network, throughout the campus. If anywhere any webinar is going to organize, and we are ready to help, and we are helping the other department for organizing this webinar. So this role of library professionals are improving in teaching and learning, and it is not limited to the academic libraries. This happens in any type of library, including the public libraries. So in fact, library should be a place for both formal as well as informal learning, fostering continuous professional development in various disciplines in collaboration with other departments. As you have seen, we have organized the webinars with collaboration with other departments. So this is a live example. So modern day library professionals are part of curriculum design committee and collaborate with the teachers to strengthen the teaching and research by providing access to the world of research literature and digital resources for teaching and learning. Library professionals all over the world are playing active role in promoting online educational resource used by teachers and students, evaluating the quality of online educational resources for use by specific students and teachers, and by curating the OER in different disciplines. In fact, the InfliBNet's ePathshala has over 17,000 modules for OER in over 75 disciplines. How they are being used? Open access, which is the provision of free access to peer-reviewed scholarly and research information to all. It envisages that the right holder grants worldwide irrevocable right of access to copy, use, distribute, transmit, and make derivative works in any format for any lawful activities with proper attributions to the original author. The modern library professionals in the universities are therefore undertaking several activities beyond their traditional roles. They are now active researchers in bibliometric to support institutional needs. They use technology innovatively to support teaching and learning. Many libraries manage learning management system, undertake teaching quality assessment for quality assurance, keep record of institutional research by managing institutional repository. So this slide is showing the traditional library that we have the hard copies of the books for issue and return, as well as we are providing the Kindle for accessing the e-resources. So all the books, e-resources on the shelf, the libraries are providing the e-resources with the help of computer system, computer lab, and Kindle and other modern technology for the users. So this is the combination of traditional and modern library. So the emerging role of library is evident now. One other scientist I would like to quote, Boyer in 1990, he refers to the fourth component of scholarliness. So the discovery as a creation of new knowledge in a specific discipline, often used synonymously with research and closely related to scholarly communication. Integration as a making connection across the discipline, bringing in new insight, giving meaning to isolated facts, interpreting data together in an integrated manner to extend the boundaries of human knowledge. The application as a service activities that are tied directly to one's special field of knowledge and flow from the expertise of the scholar. Now, the Wheeler in 2011, he says this can also include the time spent peer reviewing journal article and grant application and sitting on various committees. As a scholarly enterprise beyond the mundane transmission of the fact, teaching is at the highest level of scholarly activity because teacher must be well informed and have expertise in their field to teach. 12 hours of classroom teaching every week can be heavy workload. If we consider the rigor needed for careful pedagogical planning and preparation needed to deliver each hour lecture in engagement with the student, certainly teaching is about inquiry into learning than simple transmission of knowledge. So higher education is not about university or college education. So it need to make the teachers aware about the learning. There is a very huge role played by the librarian to provide the materials, the latest materials, the latest models to the teachers so that they can transmit the knowledge to the students. Now I come to the next part of the slide, that is National Institute of Ranking Framework, which has been established by the Department of Higher Education, Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India. This is nothing but a methodology for ranking of universities and colleges in India. So depending upon this, an opportunity, this is this National Institute of Ranking Framework, this is an opportunity to join the process of ranking with the hope that implementation of the ranking metrics would help the universities and colleges to self-assess themselves on the quality spectrum, enhance their abilities, and hopefully find a place in the world rankings. With this hope, forwarding to the next slide. So this, I'll provide a little information or introduction to NIRF. The institution of higher education in India are in need of infusion of quality and clarity on the approach of building world-class educational institution in the Indian context and environment. New benchmark of quality need to be defined to help overall system to move up on the quality spectrum. Research, assessment, and national ranking of Indian educational institutions can play an important role in improving the performance and quality of the academic institutions. The expert committee set up by the UGC for developing National Institute of Ranking Framework for Higher Education Institutions under the ambit of University Grant Commissions discussed and deliberated upon the reputed, globally recognized ranking of the world-class universities and performance of Indian educational institutions in these rankings. Considering the fact that universities in India are essentially set up for postgraduate education and research, it was decided to assign high percentage, that is 40% weightage, to research productivity, impact, and IPR, that is intellectual property right. 30% of weightage to the teaching, learning, resources, 5% weightage to the graduation outcomes, 5% weightage to the outreach and inclusivity, and last 10% weightage to perception. Weightages assigned for ranking of colleges were suitably modified. The methodology draws from the core committee set up by the Ministry of Human Resource Development, says that it defined broad parameters to be used for ranking various university and institutions. The ranking parameters agreed by the core committee are generic in nature that has been suitably adapted for evolving a detailed methodology for ranking universities and college. The main feature of the methodology suggested, it is recommended to set up a committee which will oversee the implementation of ranking work for the first year, after which suitable ranking agency duly authorized to receive and verify the data and declare the rankings may be set up. This document identified a set of suitable form in which this parameter can be easily measured and verified across a variety of universities and colleges. A strategy suggested for calculating scores to measure the performance of universities and colleges across each such parameter. This will help to obtain an overall score for obtaining institution rank. Now, separate ranking formula for university and colleges is suggested to ensure that institutions are compared within an appropriate peer group of institution and provided a level playing field. A system for data collection for public bodies and random sample checks is suggested for each parameter. Now come to the data collection. In view of the absence of a reliable and comprehensive database that could supply all relevant information required for computing and score for ranking, it is imperative that universities and colleges that are desirous of participating in ranking exercise will be required to provide the data in the prescribed form. It is recommended that the data submitted by the universities and colleges into NRIF website should also be made available on publicly visible website by these institutions. In the interest of transparency, the data should remain there in archive form for the next 3 years to enable easy cross-checking whenever required. So those institutions that fail to do this honestly or resort to unethical practices should be automatically debarred from participation in future ranking for a period of 2 years. Their name may also be displayed in ranking portal indicating the nature of unethical conduct. An attempt should be made by the ranking authority to maintain the archived form of this data for due negligence as needed. The ranking authority or agency or board should be empowered to take up random check on record of the institution and audited account to ensure that the principles of ethical behavior are being adhered to. For some of the parameters, the data should be populated from internationally available bibliographical and citation bases like Scopus, Web of Science, Indian Citation Index, and Google Scholar. This is indicated in the assessment metrics. The ranking agency should directly access the data from these resources if necessary. Similarly, some data can be made available through a national effort. For example, data about the success of public examination can be easily compiled if all concerned bodies, UPSC, State Public Service Commission, Staff Selection Commission, GATE, NET, CAT, GMAT, CMAT, etc., conducting such examination, prepare institution-wise list, providing the details of the total number of aspirants and successful candidate from each institution. So this data can be made available through a national effort. So this data may help for ranking agency. Similarly, the universities, including affiliating one, should be able to provide examination results data in the appropriate format to evaluate the component of graduate outcome, because this graduate outcome is a part of included in the parameter for the ranking framework. So ranking based on institutional category, in view of the distinct primary mandate and objectives of the universities and colleges, separate ranking is designed for these two distinct categories of institution, as I said earlier also. So the universities would include institution of national importance set up by the Acts of Parliament like Vishwabharati, central universities, state universities, deemed to be universities, private universities, and other autonomous degree awarding institutions. The colleges would include autonomous colleges that are affiliated to universities and do not enjoy full academic autonomy. While score computations for some of the parameters are similar for both of these categories, on most count, the benchmarks are somewhat different on a few parameters to take into account the ground realities, which may be very different for the two categories. This also creates a level of playing field for both categories. The weight assigned to different components have been adjusted to reflect different mandates and expectations from universities and colleges. Even where the assessment metrics are similar, their computation, where percentile and calculations or normalizations are involved, is based on their respective categories. If implemented, in this manner and spread, the ranking methodology will produce two separate rankings, one for universities, one for colleges. So these were the extracts I have taken with the help of National Institute of Ranking Framework. We have been talking about the parameters. We have a talk about the percentage given to the teaching learning resources, lab and libraries. So these slides, what I am showing you, are taken from the manual of the National Institute of Ranking. So in this slide, there are some different parameters also. As I have talked about the people teacher ratio, I have talked about the woman involvement, the ratio of teachers or women faculty or women staff. These are the different parameters on which the facilities for the economically poor background student, economically weak students, the parameters of percentage has been given for the facilities which we are providing to differently able persons. So there are different parameters and marks given for this. That's why I was talking about the people teacher ratio. That's why I was talking about the female teachers and male teachers ratio, as well as the female male percentage of staff in any university or institution. So this is the present slide. What you are being is the exact extract of the from the NIRF, National Institute of Ranking Framework Manual. If you will come across, you will see the same thing. So teaching and learning resources, TLR, this parameter, where the teacher-student ratio emphasis on permanent faculty, they have given 25 marks. Combined metric for faculty with PhD and experiments, 25 marks. Now come to my topic, which was main role of libraries in ranking. So the metrics for library and lab facility, they are giving 40 marks. That means 20 marks for the library and 20 marks for the laboratory facilities. When we library professionals, when we are in the emerging career, the pass out student from the library schools. So we have fortunately or unfortunately, we have seen such things that in case of private colleges, when they are, when these private schools or private colleges, where they are in need of getting affiliation from ICSE, in case of a school, they need affiliation from ICSE or CBSE board or other boards. And in case of colleges, especially private colleges for BEds, there are mushroom growths of private colleges and private school who are running for the affiliation. So there is those private schools and colleges, they are recruiting the fresh library professionals or fresh come out from a library professional for the institution. Because for getting the affiliation, these private school or colleges need to show that they have a trained library profession who can set up a good library within a limited time before the affiliation bodies come for the inspection of the school and colleges. So we can say that this emerging newcomers of the library schools, they get a chance for these private schools and colleges, they get a chance for their career advancement. But at the same time, there is something we can say, after the affiliation, these library professionals, in case of school or colleges, they have assigned different works apart from the setting up the libraries. So once they are getting the affiliation, or once they are getting the respective marks for affiliation, we don't put so much emphasis, we do not give so much weightage to the library professionals. So this must not happen, this should not happen. So in case of ranking, when we are talking about these marks for library or laboratory facilities, so we must give the emphasis on the library even after the rankings. Those emphasis, those governance policies should be there. So in case of coming back to this slide, in when we are talking about this National Institute of Ranking Framework, they have assigned this matrix, they have assigned these parameters and marks for these different parameters. So apart from teaching and learning, when we are talking about the library and lab facility, there is 40 marks. So 20 mark has been assigned for library facilities. So 20 marks of the library will carry a good number, will carry the institution to a higher ranking. So we must emphasize, we must think about the library facilities, library infrastructure, and the library services to put our institution on a higher ranking. So again, this matrix for library and laboratory facilities, this also has taken from the manual of NIRF. So they has, it has said that it is recommended to assign equal weightage, 20 marks each, to library and lab facilities. So in case of library, they are indicating LI. So LI, this is a simple formula, 20 into percentile parameter on the basis of annual expenditure on library resources per student. So how much we are assigning, the institution is assigning the expenditure on the library resources per student, what is that percentage that will increase the ranking of the institution? So this XLIP is the actual annual expenditure on physical resources, books, journals, etc. XLLI is the annual expenditure on electronic resources. This LI is library, and this E is indicating the electronic resources. When we are talking about the XLIIP, we are talking about the physical resources. We are talking about, as I have shown in the earlier slide, the library is emerging. This is a combination of both traditional physical books as well as e-resources, which has providing by the library through the computers, through the Kindle, and many more gadgets. So this physical annual expenditure on physical resources, books, journals, etc., and the actual annual expenditure on electronic resources, including e-books, e-journals. So is N in this indicating the total number of students. So how much we are expending, how much we are spending on per student, the library resources per student, that matters, and that carries the institution to higher ranking. If we are not providing any emphasis on the library, on the library resources, if we are not expending, we are neglecting, then we are sad to say that the ranking will go down. So expenditure on library resources per student is an very essential criteria for keep the institution on higher ranking. So this is all the metrics about the rankings provided by the NIRF. So from the part of the policymaker, from the governing body, we need to think what we are expending, what is the annual library expenditure, both on physical resources as well as electronic resources per student. As the number of students are increasing, the number of expenditure on library resources should also increase to keep the research activity learning resources at par with the student, at par with the new technology, to make the institution grow, because we have heard many quotation. I can recall the quotation, or I can remember, it's coming to my mind now. The Radhakrishnan, he said, the library is the heart of the institution, and to keep this heart growing, the library is a must, and this library is the heart of the institution. And to keep this library, to keep this heart alive, the institution will be alive. So we should keep in mind these parameters for ranking and the role of libraries for keeping the ranking of the institution higher. From the part of library professional, we should also keep in mind that we are providing at par facilities to the student, at par their convenience, ease of retrieval of information, easier, so that the students, more and more students, come to the libraries. And we can also demand the more expenditure on library resources per student. Since if we are providing good services from the library part, more students will be coming to the libraries. And from our point, from library point, we can show to the policymakers, the governing body, that more students are coming to the library, we need more expenditure on library resources. So this more expenditure on library resources mean per student will increase the ranking of the institution. Now in we come how to increase the ranking, or what is mean to be world class university. We need to increase the library facilities to attract more student, more users to the library. We need to expand our expenditure to increase the ranking of the institution. And what we need India on the global context. We need to compete with the other global universities. We want to be a world-class university. So what is mean to be a world-class university? What does it mean? A world-class university is commonly referred to as the most prestigious research universities, are essential in developing a nation's competitiveness in the global knowledge economy. These universities at the pinnacle of the higher education hierarchy play key roles in creating and disseminating knowledge, educating a highly skilled workforce for technological and intellectual leadership, and serving the needs of society. To build a world-class university in all areas of teaching, learning, research, and recreational activities need to be highly concentrated, including the library. A world-class university need a world-class library. So I'm taking the help of Jamil Salmi. 2009, in his book, he discussed the challenges of establishing world-class university in his report prepared for the World Bank. He described world-class as synonymous with globally competitive or elite or flagship. He identifies three complementary factors as prevalent in world-class university: a high concentration of talent as represented by faculty, student, and research scholar; abundant resources to offer a rich environment and to conduct advanced research; and favorable governance features. Here the term resources implicates the special role of libraries. So this slide, it shows, in order to provide, I have kept this circle blank. I want you, the library professional, to dream of, to put a picture of your own institution, of your own college, or in your own university. Dream of your own institution as a world-class university, world-class institution. We need to dream to accomplish the dream. So I have kept this circle as a blank. I want you, the library professionals, to put your institution or your college or your institution photo over here. Paste your institution or your college or university's photo here. Dream to make it a world-class university, world-class institution. To make this, you need talented faculty, student, and research scholar. You need a rich resources, that means abundant. That means no student, no user can go back without any resources. If they're asking for any resources, there should be abundant resources to provide the user, to not turn them back. So abundant of resources, rich learning environment to conduct advanced research. We have come across many of the libraries, we don't have the enough resources. We are talking about the poor infrastructure. But in order, if we there is a will, there is a way. We can increase our environment. There are colloquium, there can be, we can share our resources, electronic resources can be shared. So if there is a will, there can be many ways to increase the resources. There can be abundant resources. We can, if there's a will, we can increase, enrich our learning environment. We need a governance, favorable governance. No decision about you, without you, for a more inclusive, transparent, and effective governance. From the part of library professions, we need a favorable governance to put our institution, to make our institution a world-class institution. So we have to make sure that there is no decision about the library without the library profession for a more inclusive, transparent, and effective governance. So I hope you will paste the picture of your institution over here. We'll dream of our institution to be world-class institution. And these library professionals, we will definitely put our institution to be a world-class library, which will enhance the ranking of our institution. I'm taking the help of another scientist, Hazel Krohn. In 2013, he says in his book that world-class university or world-class system, ranking and higher education choices has highlighted main global university ranker. He writes, there is often no direct measurement. For example, there is no agreed way to measure the quality of teaching and learning. The university library may in itself possess the quality of world-class service, but it is very hypothetical to say that it will bring the quality of university at the top position. Sometimes only a library can have a world-class facility and services, but analyzing the overall aspect, it may not stand on the same. Considering the universities in India, according to the Webmetric ranking of World University, only the two are from General University, Delhi University, and Anna University. And all other top 8 universities are especially IT institute and universities. The ratio of top universities in India is 2:8. So our idea here has to be clear that the general universities are in need of extra care towards building a world-class university. Secondly, the type of university library in contemporary world is very important. One of the reasons behind the success of IT institute university library is that they may get modern technical support from their parent institution itself in compared to general university. We know that this IT, this IT institute, they have much more technical facilities, much more in terms of salaries, the teachers and the librarians, they're much higher than the general universities. So A world-class university has an international reputation for its research, has a number of research stars and world leaders in their fields, identifies and builds on its research strength, and has a distinctive reputation and focus, that is, its lead subjects, can attract and retain the best staff. We have seen many universities, those who have recruited, I will not name those universities, but there are some universities which has emerged from college to the university. They have recruited foreign faculties, but they could not retain the best staff. So we need the world-class university identify and build on its research and strength, and they can attract and retain the best staff. Not only the recruitment of the best staff, to retain the best staff, the policy, the governance should be there. So can recruit staff and student from an international market, attracts a high proportion of postgraduate students, both taught and research. So we need that stamina, we need that charisma to attract the high proportion of postgraduate students, both taught and research. Has a very sound financial base. The world-class university provide a high quality and supportive research and educational environment for both its staff and student. For example, high quality building and facilities, high quality campus. Often has a long history of superior achievement. For example, the universities of Oxford and Cambridge in the United Kingdom, and the Harvard University in the United States. From the childhood, when we are talking about the university, we had a dream that we will go to the Harvard and Oxford. And now we are calculating that to our children also, that if you have to study in university, you should have this in mind, that the Harvard and Oxford and Cambridge University. So they have a very long history of superior achievement. So they make a big contribution to society and our times. What are the challenges to build a high-ranked libraries? As I said earlier also, adequate resources. Now, this collection development, we can say in other words, the collection development, the adequate print and e-resources, so that no student, no user will have say that we are not getting enough resources from the library. So in case of collection development, the involvement of the users, the faculties, so that we have a collection development reflecting upon their users. Collection development will help to build a high rank libraries. So this collection development is the base of providing the reflecting a successful library. We have seen in the NIRF ranking also, the number of expenditure we are providing on the physical and e-resources, that matters for the ranking of the institution. Now we come to the information retrieval. That is the part of the library professional, our library friends, that ease of access and promptness. It should not be the case that if we are known to someone, we are providing the service, prompt services to the high rank or elite personalities with promptness and ease of access, we are providing them. And the common student, they are not getting the resources easily with promptness, they need to wait. So easy of access, information retrieval, promptness should be there from the part of library professionals, so that we attract more and more users, irrespective of their eliteness, irrespective of their public domain, public features. We should provide the services to everyone, irrespective of age, caste, or anything. Only collection development or ease of access or promptness would not build the high-rank libraries. Whatever we have developed, the collection developed, whatever collection is there, whether it is a print resources, whether it is e-resources, we need to conserve and preserve them. Conservation and preservation play a very important role, not only in the heritage libraries, but in case of all libraries. We should keep an eye on the conservation and preservation part, conserving the past to serve the future. So digital archiving is also required, because we are not only providing the traditional print resources, we are providing the e-resources. So we need for the digital archiving, and we need to save the past to serve the future. Modern services such as digital services, efficient and prompt, and new technologies. As I said, when we are providing the e-resources, we are having enough computers. We should have enough computers to provide the e-resources. Apart from that, we need to adapt new technologies such as Kindle or e-book readers to provide the digital services efficiently and prominently. So we need to acquire, we need to adapt the new technologies providing the modern services. Infrastructure, sufficient technical infrastructure to support the above mentioned services. As I said earlier, the emergence, the role of library professional has, in the previous slide, I've talked about the role of library professionals. They are not meant for the lending issue and return of the books anymore. All the library professionals are nowadays have adopted the technologies. They are providing the technical infrastructure to support the webinar in other department. So we need the technical infrastructure. These library professionals should be sufficient technical infrastructure to support the above mentioned services. When we were talking about the challenges, we have now the consortium to build and promote collaboration of fair use and sharing of print and e-resources. In earlier webinar, when I have talked about the remote access and discovery services, I have deliberately talked about the fair use of the e-resources, that in case of media, in case of print resources, what is the fair use, how much we can download, what is there. So I'm not going in details about it, but we should know when we are talking about the consortium, when we are talking about sharing the e-resources, we should keep in mind about the fair use, and we should have a consortium to build and promote collaboration. We are having collaboration with other libraries to have a good collection development. We are sharing our resources with fair use and print and e-resources. So this consortium is a very good concept for collection development, for sharing. And the last thing I would like about the challenges to build a high rank library is human resource management. It is the human resource management where a like-minded team and good understanding about the management, good governance to run the mechanism with enthusiasm. You need enthusiasm, you need like-minded team. If you're not having a like-minded team, you need to build a like-minded team to run the mechanism. Otherwise, there is a failure of human resource management. And when we are talking about the good governance, we should keep in mind that there is no decision about you without you. So a good human resource management will definitely build a high rank libraries. So these are the challenges to build a high rank libraries, because a high rank libraries will only put the institution on the high rank. So I'm what we have talked about in the previous slide, I would like to accumulate all of them over here in this slide. You can take this as a message to my library professionals also, that we need, in case of user, if they are confused what they really want, where to find. So it is a part of our library professional to define their requirement, what kind of book, what kind of information they are really wanting. We have faced with this kind of users. They do not know which book, which author they want, but they have some subject requirement that they need book on. Suppose the newcomers in any subject, they need a book on their own subject, but they are not they're not known about the author or any particular title. So we, from the part of library professional, we need to define their requirement. We need to locate. Suppose in case of Vishwabharati, if there's student coming from music background, we can locate that. You can find this information from Sangeet Bhavan library. You can find this information from, if the student from art, we can find this information to the Kala Bhavan much more. So this is the location of environment, location of information, and within the within any institution, if in the student, the users are coming with the major of information, their information is not accurate, we need, we the library professional need to locate the information where the information could be much more refined, much more accurate for them. Sometimes we need to select which book may help for their better understanding. Suppose they are the newcomers or they do not have the depth information about the subject. So what is the, for a layman, what which book or which information can help them? We need to select them. We need to organize our own collection for easy retrieval of information. These organization can be physical, the physical rack rectification, as well as the online resources rectification. From time to time, as we are organizing our own wardrobes, our own books at home, we need to look at the institution racks. We need to look at the e-resources racks. How can the best information can be there? We need to organize our online access catalog from time to time. So this is the organization. And for the presentation, when we are presenting this information, when we are presenting our resources to the user, we need to present our information in a very good form so that we can, the user can help, the user will come again and again to our library. And then more number of users into the library means we can go to the policymaker, we can claim to the governance that number of users have increased. We need to increase the expenditure on library resources. So presentation is an important part from the library professional, and to assess what we have done, where we were, where was the library, and where we have come across. So the upgradation of the library need to be assessed. We need to congratulate our library team for a good teamwork. Without a good team, the whole library could not succeed, could not grow. So each and every component need to be congratulated, need to be encouraged to have a good human resource management. And we need to assess our own work, where we have putting our library, and in consequently we are putting our institution. So the goal of library professional should be to increase the library users, as well as increase the ranking of the institution, where whichever, whatever institution you belong to. So when we are coming to we have talked about the higher education. What is higher education? What is a National Institute of Ranking Framework? What is their manuals? What are their parameters? How they are putting the library? What is the percentage of marks they are giving to the libraries? We have talked about this in the previous slides. We are dreaming about the world-class university. For dreaming, we need to know what is world-class university. So there was a message to my library professionals that how we can increase this library access how we can increase the use of library so that we can also become a world-class library, and consequently we can increase the ranking. Now I am coming again a very short message to my library friends, that working hard for something we don't care is called stress. So we do not need to take any stress, because working hard for something we don't care is called stress. We don't need to take a stress. And from the human resource management perspective, I would like to say to the leaders, there should be that the leader should identify their team who are good at which work. If some are good at the technical work, that it is for the leaders to, it is from the leader's perspective to put that human resource, put that team, put that person in that particular work, so that it is not stress for him or her. And working hard for something we love is called passion. So from the human resource management perspective, it is the point of the leader who should think who is good at which work and putting that person to that work, so that it is not a stress for him and he or she love that his work. So working hard for something we love is called passion. So from the library professional, we should work for with passion, and we should not take it as a stress. And if I want to be a good leader from the library professional, I should identify the person working under me who is good at which work, and I should put that person, him or her, in that work, so that she does not take stress, she or he does not take stress, and she do that work passionately. I am taking the help of this slide again. I am repeating this slide intentionally, because in this passing time, when we are watching the news, when we are watching, we are reading the newspaper. I hardly read newspaper nowadays, but when we are watching this news, so there are some news which are bringing tears to our eyes globally. I would not say that it is variation from person to person, but I must say globally the things what we are going around is not at all very positive, but we have to take the positive things. So the burden of education, I have taken this slide, which was the report of 2017. Now in the era of 2020, when we are attacked by so many pandemic, so many things, so after the COVID attacks, so many consequences has come out. So many have lost their jobs, so many are dying without bread. So at that time, this burden of education is much more. Many, many, many of the students, many of the students who were thinking, who were dreaming of the education, they will be out of institute, because their parents cannot provide the education. They are not providing the bread, that's why they are just sending, they are wedding off their girl child marriage is on the rise. So at this time, the burden of education is much, much higher. So it is my request to my library professional that keep this in mind, the burden of education, what it was in 2017, it is much, much higher in 2020. If we cannot bring the change globally, at least from our part, from our end, we can provide the ease of access, prompt of information to our student, to our user, so that at least it can help anyone, anywhere, so we can bring the change in the society. So in the next few slides, I will share some of the next slides are requests to my library professionals. that kiosk is work to dancing star, as said by Frederick, and kindly remember that all deep uncertainty brings with it, for those with the eyes to see it, a glorious opportunity to grow your creativity massively. So we are under the deep uncertainty, but we need a glorious, but we need an eye to see a glorious opportunity to grow your creativity massively. If you wish to use this time to mine your genius and discover ideas that will raise your craft, enthusiasm, and impact. When it comes to bringing up new works, please know that worrying too much about logistics keep you stuck in logic. A place for great limitation versus great inspiration and flights of your unbridled genius. And obsessing with perfection is the enemy of creativity. These are all my suggestions. And giving a gift and expecting a return is not a gift at all. It is an exchange. If we are providing companies of services from the library part, it is a gift. We should not expect in return. Then it will become an exchange. It will not remain a gift. What makes giving a move that so wonderful that it borders on the mystical and the intention with which you give it? And if you want something back, you pollute the beauty of the present that you are giving. If you are providing the services, don't expect anything back. For that, you need to be a benevolent person. What is a benevolent person? A benevolent person, be a leader, producer, creator, or performer, is to do what you do in purity, for the right reason, in high integrity, only for the good of the other people. And doing creative work that fills you with joy is a gorgeous route to happiness. You do not need to take stress. When you are doing the creative work, you're feeling with joy is a gorgeous route to happiness. And the more happy you are, the longer you will live. And for a good health, keep on going the creative work. Do not do it for the fame, fortune, and applause it will bring you. These things never last. Fame, fortune, and applause, these things never last. Do it for the stain it removes from your soul and for the people who will be blessed by your genius. At the workplace, when you are working from your heart, you will experience a good sleep. You do not need to take sleeping pills. So do your creative work, do it with happiness. This happiness will give you a longer life and it will remove the stain from your soul. And for the people who will be blessed by your genius. The idea that working longer and harder makes you more productive and better is outdated. This is all my suggestion. It may create chaos. It may attract criticism. I don't bother about it. But I think that it comes from the area when the most workers toil on a factory line, and by putting in more hours, they would create more products. For creative professional versus manual labor, you get rewarded not only by the length of time you put in, but by the degree of mastery that you put out. As a matter of fact, for those in the industry that must deliver world-class artistry, working more often produces less, because we do not get the time to contemplate and study and allow beautiful new ideas to incubate. Thank you everyone for a patient listening. And give a thought from your part to do the creative work to bring the change in the society. Thank you, everyone.
All are requested to mute their microphone if you don't have any question. If you have any question, then you can unmute the microphone and then raise the question.
How to?
Yes, please.
Sir, my question is, a student in library.
I cannot hear.
Hello?
Hello.
Please, your question is not clear, please.
My question is that, how to track the student in library?
Can you type the question? Can you send in the chat box?
You just write the chat box, then we will give the answer.
Okay.
He's not audible at all.
There is a sound problem from your end. We cannot hear you properly.
Okay, sir.
So you may use the chat box and also mail. Mail ID is also given our website.
So in order okay. to attract, can you hear me? In order to attract the students in the library, we need a prompt services, huge abundant resources. If we are not having enough resources which will help them, how will they come? In order to attract the student, we need to provide the promptness of services, easy of retrieval of information, a good collection. If you are not having a good collection, if they're not getting the required information, why will they come to the library? The attraction of the library lies in the collection. If you are having latest collection or the collection up to their own, which is required in their own subject, they will definitely come. And from the part of the library professional, the ease of access should be there. If you are providing the card catalog, it should be there so that they can start. If you are providing online catalog, the enough infrastructure should be there that if there are 10 students, 10 of them are getting the computer to search for the resources, as well as the sometimes we see the complaint from the student side that the professionals who are sitting in the front bench, they are not providing quick services. So promptness of services is also there to attract the users in the library. Any more questions?
Any more question from anyone?
Hello.
Hello. Yes.
Digital archiving. Yes.
Yeah.
We can have digital archivings. And in fact, in Vishwa Bharati Library Network, we are providing the digital archivings of the from the faculty, from the staffs. We are maintaining a repository, digital archives of the information. We can create. Hope I answered your question. Did it meet your expectation?
Thank you.
Thank you, Prabhat, for your nice and informative presentation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone, for this particular network.
Now, all are requested to open your video to take a session photo right now. Just you open your video, you will take a session photo of the participants. Okay. Please open your video option. Screen not yet full. Okay, thank you very much. Shanada, if you any announcement for tomorrow's lectures, then you can make.